If you look at the book of Matthew, chapter 23. Matthew chapter 23, verse 25. Matthew 23, 25. It says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you please the outside of the cup and dish, but in the inside they are full of extortion and self-indulgence." Yes, you've cleaned up the outside, holy brother, holy sister. You dress very holy. When we look at you, oh, wonderful, this must be a pastor. When we look at you, oh, this must be a holy sister. But you said the inside is full of self-indulgence. You are self-filled. The only thing that propels you is self. The reason why you come to church is to self-glorify. The reason why you serve God, you do it, is for you are just self. Your heart is full of envy, hatred, all kinds of, all manner of evil is in that heart. You can deceive man. But God says that his solid foundation stands sure. He knows that are those that are his. If we also look at the book of Ezekiel, where we read earlier, let's go to Ezekiel chapter 33 and read 31. Ezekiel 33 and read 31. He says, "So they come to you as people do. They sit before you as my people, and they hear your words, but they do not do them. For with their mouth they show much love, but their hearts pursue their own gain." Gather, holy brother, holy sister, we show much love with our mouth. See, our hearts pursue our own gain. It's not the gain of the Lord. It's not the glory of God. It's not the lifting up of the gospel, of the things of God, for the sake of God, for the sake of others. It is our own gains that our hearts pursue. That's why when you envy is still in your heart, you see your brother excelling, you are envious. You see your sister, you are envious. You see this happen. That's why a lot of envy, a lot of things, self, still in you. God says they draw it with much love. They show it with their mouth, their lips, but their hearts. Is just geared towards their own gain. So I know them. So I know all of you. So you can do whatever you like. So I know you. What God is saying. If you also claim to be a Christian, you're a Christian sister, a Christian brother, and you still dress like Jezebel, proclaiming that God only looks at the heart. It doesn't care about my outward appearance, what I look like in the outside, whether I look like a harlot or I look like a Jezebel, I look like whatsoever. God doesn't. He only looks at the heart. Let me tell you, you are right. 110% correct. God only looks at the heart. That's true. But let me tell you what God says. A good tree cannot bear bad fruits. If you are a good tree, you cannot bear provocative or bad dressing. You will not be able to dress ungodly or to wear a cloth or dress in a way that diminishes the image of God. If you're a good tree, you can only deceive those who do not know the Bible and deceive others, but God is not mocked. And people like me who may know what God is saying, we are not fooled. Just another thing that God says. He says, guard your heart with what? All diligence. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. Therefore, out of it flows what? The issues of life. Issues in the plural. Is your clothing, dressing, part of issues of life? Can you take away dressing from your issues of life? You don't worry about dressing. You don't dress. Dressing is not part of the issues of your life. Out of it flows the issues of life, including dressing, the way you talk, everything. So let me ask you, young man. When you go to the gym and you carry iron and you come and put on a baby's clothes and you stand in the mirror and you're doing like this and doing like this, and then you have these ladies and you go, you put on this thing that shows your breast and shows your nakedness and everything, your cleavages, everything that makes you a woman is in the open. When you look at yourself in the mirror and you take your Jezebelic painting and you paint your face, what is in your heart? Are you coming as someone, when you dress and come out like God will look at you and say, oh, you are so beautiful. And God will start lusting after you. God will start to, you know, this you with this, honey, you are so free. Is that why you do it? Don't deceive yourself. It's out of the filthiness of your heart that you're doing it. The purpose is that when you come out, you will entice others. When you come out, you will get cheap accolades. When you come out, men will look at you and lust. Women will look at you and say, you are sexy, you are low. Look at this. That is the only purpose. He is to get others to fall, knowingly or unknowingly to you, you are an agent of darkness, bringing many to hell. God will not take it kindly with you. The same Jesus who said in Matthew chapter 5, verses 28 and 27, or 27 and 28, he said, if a man should look at a woman to lust after her, he said, he has already committed adultery in himself. And this is the purpose why you dress and wear those things. So you entice men. So you entice women. When you come out, everybody will see how sexy you are. You're wonderfully built. Show them all your cleavage, all your shape, everything. And you take time to walk, like the Bible describes them, saying they walk and they are mincing and, you know, demonstrating so people can see you. And who are you fooling? God only looks at the heart, your rights. He looks at the heart. Because out of the heart flows all the issues of life. That when someone can cover himself as a masquerade, and God will look at him and say, this son, I don't know you. Because he sees the heart. That way you can still dress like anyhow. God don't need to look at your dresses. He sees the heart. He sees what is driving it. It's not food. So the inside cannot be clean and the outside be filthy. It's impossible. Bible says, Jesus says what? Out of the heart flows all the issues of life. Everything comes from the heart. Out of it come theft. Out of it come murder. Matthew chapter 15. Out of it come adultery. Out of it come fornication. Out of it comes every evil thing in this life. Out of the heart is the seat of every action. So the way you behave, the way you dress, the way you act, the way you talk tells me all that is in you. One thing, gift God has given me in life is that I could quickly discern people. Some time ago, I was with a friend and we had a business meeting with someone in Nigeria a long time ago. And we walked out of our meeting and you only said, hey, he's known this person for a long time, great person you've been talking about. And I came in the room and after the meeting I walked out, I said, I have nothing to do with this man. So the day you have anything to do with this man, you will cry and nobody will hear your voice. He said, what? You've known this man all this year. I only stayed with him for 1 week, for a few hours. He had a business talk. So I had nothing to do with this man. When he was so enticed in the business, I'm just giving one example of all my life, just one little. He went and did the business. Every day, Mr. Harris said, Mike has killed me. Mike. You know? But how do I know this? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. You cannot fool people. When you talk, when you act, when you dread, everything you do is tells who you are. It's not magic. You that's why you are your word. You are everything you do. It's the Caucasian of who you are. They manifest from the heart. And that's why Jesus is saying to us today, says, except you repent, you will likewise perish like the rest of the world. If you look at the disciples, could Jesus be wrong? The disciples who was rebuking and telling them, except they likewise repent, they will likewise perish like the rest of the world. Hence they knew Jesus. But look at them, there were few we envy. Who will be the greatest? Lord, I want to sit at your right. I want to sit at your left. Have you seen what's in their heart? Yeah, they know Jesus. Most of us are like that. They are still fighting who will be the general overseer of the church, who will be the next to the pastor, who will inherit, who will become the assistant pastor, who will become the choir leader. We are still fighting over this trivial nonsense. You are still filled with self-indulgence. We've not started yet. My prayer is that after today we will start in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if we look at the Bible, let us look at the book of Titus, chapter 1, verse 16. It says, Titus chapter 1, verse 16. It says, they profess to know God, but in works they deny him, being abominable, disobedient, and disqualified for every good works. They profess to know God, but what in works they deny God, being abominable, and they are disqualified from every good works. You see what God said in Ezekiel, what we read earlier? Ezekiel 33, verse 12 and 13. He says, that the day you turn away to do evil, he said, all your righteousness will not be forgotten. He said, when you live in disobedience and say you are disqualified from every good works, all your giving, all your service, all everything, said, God has disqualified you, your service is in vain. You're just wasting time and waiting for hellfire. God only recognizes your service, your good works, when it is done in righteousness. He said, it's not, he's a holy God. When you're doing it in righteousness, what you're trying to do is to bribe God with your good work. Can God be bribed? Is he a corrupt judge? You cannot bribe God with your good works. Your good works are only acceptable to him if it is done in righteousness. Then it becomes a sweet smelling aroma to God. The God can receive it. God will be gladdened. It will be recorded to you in the book of remembrance. Then you will have eternal reward for it. But if it is done in unrighteousness, you're just wasting your time. God said you are already disqualified from every good works.